Good morning, everyone. And my thanks to Roger, whom I've known for many years, not recently well, but knew him when he was a district administrator. How far we have come. And I know that he takes great pleasure in his ministry to you. And just in the few minutes that I've been peering around the corner to see you, I sense the spirit here and the warmth and the generosity as you smile at one another and welcome each other into the Sunday morning of worship and reflection and greetings. So, two thoughts to ponder. First reading, in about 598 BCE, the Jews of Judea were conquered by the Babylonians. Their temple was destroyed, and many were exiled in captivity and suffered from isolation, defeat, and homesickness. They longed for their homeland, for their rituals, and their music. Although the exiles still have their harps, they have no hope and cannot play. They have no hope, and they will not sing. From Psalm 137, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there we hung up our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors asked for mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. But how could we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? The second reading, in her poem, Won't You Celebrate With Me, Louise Clifton, non-white and woman, celebrates her survival in a contemporary Babylon. Won't you celebrate with me? Won't you celebrate with me what I have shaped into a kind of life? I had no model, born in Babylon, both non-white and woman. What did I see to be except myself? I made it up here on this bridge between star shine and clay, my one hand holding tight my other hand. Come celebrate with me that every day something has tried to kill me and has failed. When we are very ill, we feel exiled from our bodies. Our body isn't cooperating as it used to or doing what we expect of it. It rejects familiar foods, becomes inexplicably and prematurely tired. It hurts in unfamiliar places. And what we hoped would just go away doesn't. And we may be forced to hand ourselves over to doctors, radiologists, neurologists, or surgeons, or psychiatrists. Most likely, all strangers who ask the same questions repeatedly. And we wait for long periods in strange rooms, exiled from our familiar home. Mental illness or extended emotional distress may have the same consequences. A loss of familiarity with one's very self, a sense of dislocation with an inadequate map, a world that is gray and seasonless, day and night merging together in a low hum. Mental illness may not kill us as quickly as a malignant cancer, but it can kill or make one feel that life is not worth living. Hope can change the way we experience illness. It can help us focus less on what we cannot control and more on what we can. Hope helps us prioritize what is important and what's not. Now remember, clearly, I'm not talking about the hope of everyday greetings and conversations, such as, I hope you have a nice day. But the kernel of gladness that survives in the most grim circumstances, such as exile and captivity in a foreign land without the promise of reprieve or rescue. Again, before we go any further, we should first consider an important distinction between cure and heal. The idea I've invited you to tangle with today is, can hope heal, not can hope cure. To be cured is when a treatment of a disease, usually diagnosed by a physician, with medicine or surgery that eliminates the disease itself. Surgery removes the cancerous tumor, radiation eliminates the cancer cells that have migrated from the original site. Penicillin targets the streptococcal infection, overwhelms and eliminates it, and you're cured of strep throat. Healing is a process. After surgery, the body is healing, undertaking the repair of tissues, reestablishing the functions and the balance of the body systems. Increasingly, we recognize that serious illness can injure or insult our psyches too. Confidence suffers, anxiety remains, and we remain prematurely and unsettlingly aware of our mortality. Healing comes from within, but isn't always self-generated. Even late in life, we can learn from the positive examples of others, from reflection, from conversation, prayer, meditation, literature, and poetry. Healing may bring together the often hidden aspects of our life as they relate to our illness. Acceptance of the condition and events of one's life is key to healing. This is an integrative process, and I believe it is one of the key tasks of aging. Finally, one can be healed and go on to die of illness. Healing and death are not mutually exclusive. Sometimes proponents of holistic healing do not acknowledge this truth, and it's implied that death is a personal failure. This is so untrue and so damaging. One author wrote, "Even if we are losing ground physically, there's extraordinary emotional, mental, and spiritual healing that can go on. For this individual, her cancer was an opportunity to ask herself how she wanted to reinvent her life. For her, this was a powerful healing opportunity." I admit the question posed in my sermon title, "Can Hope Heal?" was rhetorical. During the week of pondering this sermon and writing it, I regretted that wording because I believe and I know that hope can heal and does heal. And perhaps I should have said outright, hope helps healing, even though that would not be conducive to conversation. Now, having answered my own question, I invite you instead to wonder with me about the nature of hope and how we might understand it in the context of healing. Hope is challenging to define, which may be why we tend to describe it metaphorically. It is deeper than optimism and more mysterious than positive thinking. It is an element of believing good will come, even if there is no way to prove it with evidence or facts. Belief and expectation are key elements of hope. However, rigid beliefs can stifle hope, and expectations are best held loosely. Hope takes imagination. It took an imagination like Emily Dickinson's to write this now well-known poem about hope, which is full of metaphors from first line to last. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be that storm that could abash the little bird that has kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never In extremity, it asked a crumb of me. In the context of illness, hope used to be the domain of clergy and social workers because it was seen as solely a matter of faith, and its effect could not be measured or quantified or replicated. This belief is changing. In his book, The Anatomy of Hope, physician and oncologist Jerome Groopman writes, researchers are learning that a change in mindset has the power to alter neurochemistry. Belief and expectations, the elements of hope, can block pain by releasing the brain's endorphins, mimicking the effects of morphine. In some cases, hope can also have the important effects on the fundamental physiological processes like respiration, circulation, and motor function. However, even if one has hope, that does not make one solely responsible for those biological functions. Again, even with hope and even with healing, the body, the natural thing for the body, may be to pass into death. But hope can help us imagine the future in a positive light. Hope is also a moving target. Sarah, for example, is a 55-year-old woman with a recent cancer diagnosis. She is hopeful the recommended treatment will cure her, but the treatment is not successful. But she still has a reason to hope that another treatment will be. That treatment fails too, but now she is too weak for another round. So Susan, with encouragement from her doctors, hopes for remission, if not a cure. And after a brief respite, the cancer returns. She hopes that medicines will palliate or moderate the symptoms. When it becomes clear that this disease will end her life sooner rather than later, she chooses to die at home with hospice care to manage her symptoms and among people who love and comfort her during that passage. Now, this is a sanitized illustration. She, Sarah, will most certainly experience confusion and anger, fear and disappointment at each turn of events. But with the help of a caring, compassionate others, many will be able to make peace with this. Others, despite the help of caring, compassionate companions, may not. My personal experience is that many people with a firm belief in an afterlife, especially the elderly who have experienced the deaths of family and many friends, aren't so concerned with hope because they have certainty. Certainty that, among some believers, that there is more, and that more is reuniting with loved ones who are waiting for them, and returning to the loving source of creation, whom they may call God. And I have met with many other elders who are content with having lived good lives and leaving their unique legacies in word and deed and memory. They are very clear they don't need or expect anything in particular after death. So does hope heal? Not everyone, not all the time. But my most compelling story that proves that it can is my own. Claire is my husband's and my first child. She is 40 now. She is funny. She has an ear for music, knows about 200 songs, and will sing them anywhere for anyone. She is affectionate, compassionate, a good sister, and a loving aunt. She also has intellectual disabilities, a tendency to psychotic-like behavior, such as hearing voices and talking to herself very loudly in public at inconvenient times. And try as she might, she will never read past a first grade level. She will never be able to cross a street to safety. Yet we love her and others love her just as she is, in some part because we can't change her, but in large part because she really is perfect just the way she is. This wasn't always the case. When she was young, when I was young, I had a really hard time accepting her the way she was. She was late in her developmental milestones. There were endless doctor's visits and absolutely not a miracle in sight. We were good parents. I was a very good mother. I loved her, played with her, and to all outward appearances, absolutely devoted to her well-being. But there was some kernel of disappointment and sadness that I held on to tightly. I felt hopeless, but not about her. I felt hopeless about myself, about my inability to love and accept her unconditionally. Our family, which now included two younger sisters, was in church one Christmas Eve. Claire was around 12, and I was looking at Claire and her sisters, their ease with one another, their engagement with the Christmas story, and suddenly I felt an ease within myself. I felt release from my hypervigilance about who Claire was and my self-imposed responsibility for creating her. I felt a weight lifted off my shoulders. There was an unfamiliar spaciousness. I understand now, with the distance of some 30 years, that hope replaced unrealistic expectations of myself and my idea of the perfect mother who can help create the perfect child. That hope was for the imperfect mother to love the imperfect child, and that that would be good enough. Hope came, light as feathers, arriving unbidden and resting on my shoulders. It expected nothing of me. With it came an invitation to healing, hope and healing on Christmas Eve. May all of humankind be offered the invitation to heal and the certainty of hope. May each and every one of you come to know what your deepest need is, and may hope touch that very tender place. And when hope finds that place that yearns for touch and for healing, may it be opened and healed. May you feel the blessings of the world and the blessings you may bring upon yourself and to others. May all this be so. Amen. Thank you. And now, in our comings and goings, may the light of love shine upon us, out from within us. Be gracious unto us and give us peace. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.